I don't know Cammy. I know Don, and Don's a great guy. I'm sure if you were to take, go up there and take the time to do that, it'd be well worth your time. It's up in Centerville. We need to get like a little board to pin stuff on. We haven't done it. Sarah said that it'll come probably when the door comes, but. So for now, we'll put it back on the table. If you guys want to take a look at it, that's where it'll be after it's no longer on this table. It'll be on some table for a while. If you guys were not here on Friday, I have one extra paper. I don't know where or where who it belongs to. But anybody who was not here on Friday, I have the extra papers for that. And if you guys have not joined in the classes, we got all new folders. So if you guys want a folder for the information, we have those too. So, whatever you guys need, we will provide. We are in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. We ended chapter 4. We ended 4 and verse 13, I believe, is where we had left off last week. So we'll pick up there in verse 13 of Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Before we begin, Lee, would you mind reading some word prayer?
Let us pray. Our Father, Lord God, who art in heaven, you are so awesome, you are so great. We are so thankful to be able to be in your presence this afternoon, to be able to gather together as your children, to be able to come together to study from your word, to learn the lessons that we can apply to our lives so that we may be better servants in your kingdom, so that we will be better children. Help us, Father, to love you, glorify you, honor you. Help us to always be mindful of your great and awesome love for us, the love that was willing to love us so much to allow your Son to come to this earth to die on the cross for our sins. We thank you so much for that amazing love, and we ask that you help us to pattern our lives after the example that Jesus left for us, that we may be better servants in your kingdom, that we may always strive to do your will. We thank you for this hour of Bible study that we have to look into your word. We thank you so much for Chad, for him and for his family, and for the work that he does with us here in Williamsburg. We ask that you be with him as he guides us through this study this afternoon. Help us that we may each dig into Ecclesiastes. Help us that we may apply the things that we learned to our lives. I ask that you go with us through this study. In Christ's name we pray.
All right. Here at the end of chapter 4, he has dealt with some of the same mentality through chapter 4. We had mentioned before that as you kind of move through these ponderings, these wrestlings that Solomon has, he will dive into areas that he looks kind of from a worldly perspective, and those are usually denoted by the phrase under the sun. And then he'll talk about things kind of from a larger view, more than just things that happen under the sun. And he usually frames those topics by talking directly about God. So most of chapter 4, in fact, I think almost all of chapter 4, is kind of categorized by the phrase under the sun. He mentions it in verse 1. He mentions it again in verse 3. It's there again in verse 7. And as we get to the very end of chapter 4, he'll mention it again in verse 15. And so most of everything that he talks about in chapter 4 is kind of with an earthly perspective, to some degree. It's always kind of a lot of asterisks in Ecclesiastes. Let's pick up there in verse 13. If someone would, let's read verses 13 through the end of the chapter.
Better a poor and wise youth than an old and foolish king that will be admonished no more. For he comes out of prison to be king, although he was born poor in his kingdom. I saw all that living who walk under the sun. They were with the second youth who stands in his place. There was no end of all the people over whom he was made king. Yet those who come afterward will not rejoice in him. Surely this also is vanity and grasping for the wind.
Thank you, Matt. When he introduces this wise youth there in verse 13, and then gives either a hypothetical situation or one that Solomon has witnessed, either personally or through history, who does this sound like? Some do. Some of the details. We have anybody who was a youth who was led out of prison and became maybe not a king, but second in charge?
Joseph.
Maybe that tends to, kind of where my mind goes is Joseph in this occasion. And he's comparing this wise youth in verse 13 with whom?
Darkness.
A foolish king. So here's a king who, as he says in verse 13, can no longer take advice. Now, why would he compare these two individuals, a wise youth and a foolish king? Or a king who cannot take advice?
Because they seem to contradict each other.
Okay.
You would expect the youth to be the unwise and the king to be the wise.
Yeah, so on the one hand, you have experience. Solomon talks about this in Proverbs, woe to you, land, whenever your king is of age, an infant. We understand, even if in a monarchy, if the king dies and his son is six, are you going to really let the six-year-old truly rule the country? That would be even worse. So what do they usually do, even at that time period? They put in a vassal king. They put in someone to act in the king's place until he's old enough. Because here's a person who, A, just lacks knowledge, let alone any sense of his responsibility. But even as a young person, no offense to young people, what you lack is always going to be, at this age, experience. You just do not know what you do not know. Things you've never been through before, you simply have never been through before. It's not a failing, it's just a fact of life. So if you were to choose a king who had experience or a youth, you would usually pick a man who has experience. But he says that it's better to be a wise youth without experience than someone who has experience but cannot take advice. It really goes to show how important advice is at all stages of life. So he then talks about this wise youth in verse 14, though he went from the prison to the throne, though his own kingdom, or through his, in his own kingdom, he has been born poor. And I saw all the living who move about under the sun, along with that youth who was to stand in the king's place. There was no end to all the people to whom he was to lead, and yet those who come after him do not rejoice in him. Surely this also is vanity and striving after wisdom. What is his point with this illustration or this example? It seems like it's almost out of nowhere, where he just talks about this person who went from prison to the throne and his kingdom, kind of expectedly, like, have a little more detail to the story rather than simple anecdote. To some degree, he is putting this in an extreme word. So here you are young, and you've gone from prison, the lowest place in society, to the throne, the highest place in society. And he mentions it being a big kingdom, where there is no end of all the people whom you are to lead. What more would you want out of life at that point? You have your youth, where you can still do stuff and not hurt all the time. Just the fact of life. You have the power and money and influence, not only a large kingdom that you can do a lot with. But remember, he puts this phrasing there in verse 15, under the sun, and then his conclusion in verse 16, that this is vanity and striving after wind. So why is this vanity and striving after wind? Why is that the case? remember, the wording of vanity is not always as we think of vain, but fleeting. So I think in this case, fleeting is probably the better reading. That's closer to the Hebrew direct word-for-word translation. Because in verse 16, what does he say is not going to happen? Even though this man has achieved kind of every marker of worldly success, what is not going to last?
The kingdom.
The kingdom is not going to last. He makes the point that those who come later will not rejoice in him. Now, if we're thinking of Joseph, what is the opening salvo in Exodus chapter 1?
Pharaoh who did not know Joseph.
Yep. Which fits in really beautifully with this little section of text. There arose a king who knew not Joseph, or there arose a people who did not rejoice in him. So you have, here goes a young man from prison to the throne. He rules over half the kingdom, brings his family, puts them in the best land in Egypt, and then three generations later, there arose a king who knew not Joseph and put all of his work under bondage.
Really wish that Solomon's son would have been listening to this too, because he had the opportunity as a young man to take over the kingdom after Solomon Rehoboam, and he could have and should have learned from the wisdom of his father, but instead, and he decides to take, instead of from wise counselors, he chooses younger unwise counselors to counsel him, and he was just born from him. Also made me think then the opposite of that, Josiah, obviously the future where Solomon's writing, who had somebody that was a wise, even being, 7 years old, when he becomes king, but yet he has Jehoiada, the priest, to be able to counsel him wisely, so you see the wisdom of a man even at 7, becoming king, and by 16, and by 18, I forget all the actual triggers there when you read about Josiah, you see how well he is doing with wisdom and turning the kingdom back to God. So it really is important, whether we're young or old, who do we turn to for counsel?
Excellent. Any questions or comments at the end of chapter 4? So we have gone through chapter 4 where he's mentioned under the sun, and under the sun, and under the sun, and then the beginning of chapter 5 at least, for a hiatus, stops the topic of under the sun and begins to talk about God. And Solomon seems to have a better perspective or a longer perspective of things whenever he then begins to reason and wrestle with stuff with God in mind. So he'll get back to the topic of under the sun, but not until verse 13. But here in chapter 5, let's read the first 3 verses.
Walk prudently when you go to the house of God, and draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. Do not be rash with your mouth, and let not your heart utter anything hastily before God, for God is in heaven and you on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. For a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words.
Thank you. What does he mean here in verse 1, to guard your steps when you go into the house of God? I'm still deaf, so if you guys are talking, just
be careful. I mean, it's serious. This is not where we go to joke and fool around.
Is it? I always get Ephesians and Galatians mixed up because they're the exact same layout in my Bible, where Paul tells us to walk circumspectly.
Levi, get your booger hanging out.
Chapter 5. It is very similar ideas to guard your steps or to walk circumspectly, to pay attention to where or how you walk. Probably a terrible. We were in the guardhouse and Indiana Jones was on the TV. And makes me think of where he goes into the temple and he has to walk, terrible example. It has nothing to do with this. But he garnered his steps back. We'll leave that example. Getting back to Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Is it important how you behave whenever you draw near to God? Now, our first real strong visceral example of this is Leviticus chapter 10. Who dies in Leviticus chapter 10?
Nadab
and Abihu. And God sends Moses to go control Aaron to some degree and gives him a message to tell Aaron about why this happened. What is Aaron told in Leviticus chapter 10? You can even cheat.
Well, without cheating to be holy, right? Yeah, I need to be regarded as holy. Is that?
Yeah. So he says there in verse 3, amongst those who are near me, I will be sanctified, and before all the people, I will be glorified. There is an added level of expectation as you draw closer to God. And the application would be for us. You know, us is not meeting in a building to draw nearer to God, but for us to claim to be God's building. We need to guard our steps.
That was said to the man who just lost both his sons. That's how awesome, incredible, and holy God is. There was no, hey, sorry you lost your two sons. It's, I must be regarded as a people. This is not playtime. This is serious. And that's all it said. You know, there's no warning. For sure that there have been for these two that should not have acted disrespectfully or against God. Mm-hmm.
Good point. He then goes on to expound upon this idea in verse 1 that to draw near, to listen, is better than to offer sacrifices of fools because they do not know what they're doing. Again, Nadab and Abihu seem to come to mind, where they offered the sacrifices of fools. They offered things that were unauthorized or profane before God. Right people, right place, doing the wrong thing, and that was unacceptable. What are some other applications for us? Consider.
I was also going to say just carefully and purposefully, and not just stumble or, stumble into services and stumble back out with not much thought.
One of the things too comes to mind was how Samuel rebuked Saul because Saul was told to utterly destroy all the Amalekites, and they brought back what was best, and he claimed he did that to sacrifice to the Lord. And Samuel asked him, he said, which is better, to obey or to sacrifice?
That's an excellent one. That was one of my cross references that I had written down in 1 Samuel 15:22. It makes me think what Paul writes to the Romans in Romans chapter 10, dealing with his fellow countrymen, his fellow Hebrews. He says in verse 1, brothers, my heart's desire and prayer to God is for them, that they may be saved. For I bear witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of the righteousness of God, and seeking to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. For Christ is the end of the law of righteousness to everyone who believes. So the point that Paul is making here in Romans chapter 10 is you have a whole nation of Jews who believe themselves to be God worshipers and God followers, but they did not draw near to listen to what God's righteousness requires, and then just started to do all these things that they thought their sacrifice of fools, puppet would be enough. And there's so many applications to that today of individuals who, well, let's get together as a group of God's followers and let's vote on what we believe we should do. It doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense. That's what they did in 1 Samuel 15. We'll just decide what we think is right. It's what the Jews had did here in Romans chapter 10, and it's what Solomon warns us not to do. It is far better for us to draw near and listen to what God requires than to assume and absolutely be wrong. Okay?
I don't know if I should say these things, but I think when we're trying to make application, and that's what we're studying, right? If we don't make any application, if we're just talking about made evident up by you, I don't bring fire before God when we come to worship, so you know, it doesn't really mean anything to me. Well, it means a whole lot because they came flippantly, carelessly, they brought the wrong fire. Whatever it was that they did, it was careless and without thought, and they just brought, came before God that way. And for us, you know, there's, you know, you can throw out all sorts of examples, but do we flippantly come to worship service? Do we surf the internet while we're here? Do we, the only time I've seen a satanic Bible in my life was in worship service at a congregation one time where kids were passing around and kind of laughing at this. You know, that's horrible. You know, we visited years ago at one place and they had like cheese flavored bread or something for the Lord's Supper. Like these are flippant, careless things that are being done supposedly in the worship to God. And do we realize that if we were under the old law, we would just get smoked in our seat, just like Nadab and Abihu did? But yet, sometimes we forget. We study these things when we talk about them, and then I grab my phone and I, you know, text my buddy, you know, or whatever during worship service, or I, you know, do, you know, misuse the elements of the Lord's Supper, you know, because it's cool or something, you know, cheese flavored and Coke or something for the emblems. Like these are things that some people in the world do. We certainly need to make sure that we're not careless or flippant when we come before God and worship.
His comments, I think of Matthew 7, verse 21, where it says, then he will say, Lord, have I not done all these things in your name? All right.
You know, the old saying that hell is paved for the road of good intentions, and there are so many times that that's exactly what we do. We have good intentions, but it's not where we draw near to listen to God. We just dive forward without pausing to consider. And that's what he's encouraging us to do. Here in verse 2, he tells us not to be rash with our mouth, nor let our heart be hasty to utter a word before God, for God's in heaven and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. Now, in the next few verses, verses 4 and following, he will get into the specifics of vows. But he isn't specific about vows in this case. So what are some other applications in verse 2 where people tend to be rash with their mouth before God?
Can't remember his name, but he said, I'm going to offer the sacrifice, the first thing that comes back to get Jephthah. Mm-hmm. You know, Nenesis' daughter. And so, you know, being careful about what we say, that we don't say something that, I think sometimes these things are said, you know, at the brink of death or something. If you save me, you know, I'm going to devote my life, and, you know, you forget what you said a minute later if you're saved.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've all spoken hastily, and maybe I wish I hadn't said that. You know, you say something, maybe you think, you know, I wish I had, why didn't I think just a few moments longer before I uttered that?
He does seem to imply it here in verse 2 that this is something that's before God or possibly even about God. And it makes me think of Job. That when Job let his words be few, it states there twice in chapter 1 and chapter 2 that all this Job did not sin with his mouth. And as you read through Job responses go from like one chapter to two chapters to three chapters to just, okay, Job, are you going to finish with your response at this point? And there comes a time towards the end of Job where he repents in dust and ashes. And there is a tendency for us as people to answer for God or on God's behalf, to be hasty with giving replies about why God would do this, or even to bring accusations against God for his actions. And part of that perspective here in verse 2 is remembering that we are on earth and God is in heaven. How many decisions are made by higher-ups in companies or in the military where they have a different perspective of the overall mission other than you sitting around in your little barracks and all you see is that? And you think, oh, their choices are really, really foolish, never seeing the whole perspective. And he gives us some of that perspective here. Is that all we are is here on earth. I get to see all that I get to see in my couple decades, all that I get to experience is what happens in my local community. And it's really hard for me to judge God when God has a higher elevation to see what's happening globally and throughout history. He then moves on to verse 3 and said, the dreams come with much business and a fool's voice with many words. What does he mean by the dream comes with much business? Or how is the phrase in the King James?
Comes from much activity.
Much activity. There is a tendency, you know, I know different people tend to actually physically dream differently. Mine tend to be like way more active than Brittany's are, and seem a lot more like graphic than hers ever seemed to be. I don't know if that's accurate, but dreams, to some people, are huge guiding forces in life, where they wake up and, you know, I'm going to do whatever I dreamt about. They put a lot of emphasis and a lot of time and effort into dreams. That seems to be what he's talking about. So if you're going to compare verse 1 to verse 3, to draw near to God and listen is better than in verse 4, the dream that comes with much business or much activity. If you're really going to guide your life, are you going to do that by your dream that you had one night, or are you going to do that by what God has laid down each permanent? I think that's a huge part.
Well, I was just thinking how sad it is that some people do that. That is how they guide their lives, by their dreams. You know, well, God talked to me last night in my dream, and so now I'm directing my life some way, but then at the same time, potentially disregard what actually God has written for me to do and told me to do, but I go with a dream.
Mm-hmm. And then he adds in there in verse 3 that a fool's voice with many words. The dream comes with much business, and a fool's voice is known by its many words. Solomon has a lot to say that we just looked at in Proverbs a few weeks ago about that very topic, that when words increase, that transgression is not lacking. And that's important. I think it's interesting that Solomon, with all of the Proverbs that he wrote, all of the sayings that he laid down, all we have left of that is Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon, and just a couple psalms. That he warns us, even in the writing of much material, in chapter 12, there is no end, recognizing that we have a tendency to go beyond what we should. We're up for a good time. Let's read verses 4 through verse 7.
When you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed. Better not to vow than to vow and not pay. Do not let your mouth cause your flesh to sin, nor say before the messenger of God that it was an error. Why should God be angry at your excuse and destroy the work of your hands? For in the multitude of dreams and many words there is also vanity, but fear God.
Where he mentioned in verse 2 not being rash with the words, he then gets a little further into the vows that people make in verse 4. Jephthah is a great example of that. I want to turn back to Psalm 15, though, for a moment. Psalm 15 is, I think, an eye-opener, especially when we talk about the vows that we make as husbands and wives. Often we make those very young in life. And sometimes we don't want to be held by those when I was too young. I don't know how many times I've heard that, you know, whenever talking to coworkers or other people. You know, yeah, I got married, but I was too young to know what I was doing. Well, you were old enough to make a vow. You were old enough to go through that. But they don't want to be held accountable. They don't want to have to go through that. Here in Psalm 15, the question is asked, very short psalm, verse 1, O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent, and who shall dwell in your holy temple? So what does it take to be close to God, to dwell in his tent? Well, he gives a couple answers, starting in verse 2. He who walks blamelessly and does what is right, speaks truth in his heart, does not slander with his tongue, and does no evil to his neighbor, takes up a reproach against his friend, and in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but who honors those who fear the Lord. But notice in verse 4, who swears to his own hurt and does not change. What David writes here in Psalm 15 is what Solomon reiterates in Ecclesiastes. And while it applies to all the vows that we could talk about, the one that comes up over and over again in my more modern conversations is, well, God just wants me to be happy in my life. And that means I got to ditch my spouse in order to be happy. Well, then that's what God wants. David asks the question, well, who gets to sojourn in God's tent? And then he gives the answer in verse 4. It's the one who is swearing to his own hurt even, and does not back up. It doesn't regress from that. And so Solomon makes the same point here in Ecclesiastes chapter 5. When you vow a vow to God, do not delay in paying it. He has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you vow. It is better that you should not vow than you should vow and then not pay. Let not your mouth lead you into sin, and then do not say before the messenger, it was just a mistake. Why should God be angry at your voice and destroy the works of your hands? And then again, we get back to that same topic in verse 7. When dreams increase and words grow many, there is much vanity, but God is the one whom you must fear. That dreams and words should not direct our lives, but the fear of the Lord should. And a lot of people, you know, talk themselves out of many words. We're going to talk ourselves out of all the things that we should have done, and talk ourselves into all the things that we shouldn't do. But the one who fears, but God is the one who wants to. And so verses 1 through 7 really deal with an eternal perspective. And he dives into wrestling with life, but with the understanding of God in that section. And then we're going to dive into some of the under the sun stuff. Any questions or comments up to verse 7? A few minutes left. How about we read verses 8 and 9?
If you see the oppression of the poor and the violent perversion of justice and righteousness in a province, do not marvel at the matter, for high official watches over high official, and higher officials are over them. Moreover, the profit of the land is for all. The king himself is served from the field.
Thank you. It's ironic that he tells you not to be amazed, and yet this one struck me a bit harder as I was reading through this for today's Bible class. Whenever you see oppression of the poor and violence of justice and the righteousness, or the violation of justice and righteousness, don't be amazed. And yet, that's what everyone wants to do today, is look around and go, there's injustice. I'm so shocked by this. Oh, look, there is oppression of other people. I am so shocked by this. Solomon makes it clear, that's always the case, pretty much everywhere. And if it isn't on one level, it's on a different level. And if it's not on this level, it's going to be a little lower down. It's always going to happen. He's not saying that this is something we just give up on, we don't strive for better. It's just an expectation that where we live is an imperfect world. And people who are imperfect are going to act imperfect. But verse 9, I know that some of the translations vary because the underlying Hebrew is not expressly clear. And when you're dealing with a language that hasn't really been spoken in a couple thousand years, it kind of gets difficult whenever you don't have a lot of repeated phrases to figure out those minutiae. So some translations say, this is gain for a land in every way, a king who is committed to cultivated fields. Or I think you said the New King James was, even the king is fed from the fields?
Certain fields.
It seems to be for both of those translations that the idea being, instead of focusing on corruption, which is a lot of what officials tend to do throughout time and geography, is to have a leader who is devoted to producing inside the economy, whether it's cultivated fields or, you know, whether it's industry, whatever it is, instead of, seems to be a mindset here in verse 9 that leadership is not to oppress others, but it's there to direct and lead others. Fair enough to phrase it that way? So here is a king who's devoted to cultivated fields, or a king who recognizes that he's served from the fields. And so his devotion is going to be to produce for the country rather than to repress the people. But here in verse 8, when you see it, don't be surprised. That is the way of the world. Any thoughts or comments on verses 8 and 9, or 9 and 10? Whenever we put our hope in this world and in our society or in our government, whenever that becomes the standard by which we set our happiness or our contentment, it's never going to work out. Solomon recognizes that even in a theocracy, as is the Jewish people when Solomon writes, was there still oppression that happened in various levels of government, even while David and Solomon were king? Absolutely. Absalom is a pretty good example of that. David reigned in the city of David, had his judgment seat there for his judgments, had people come before him to make judgments all the time, and Absalom, just outside of this, just at the gates of the city, stopped and ruined justice. Even in David's kingdom, his own son, a stone's throw from where he sat, unbeknownst to him. It always is going to happen. Obviously, the example or the implication as you get over into chapter 12 is that our hope is not in this world. You know, our expectations and our level of contentment are not set on our current government or any other government. Let's get into, we have a couple more minutes, verses 10 down to verse 12. He who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income. This also is vanity. One's goods increase, they increase who eat them. And what advantage has their owner but to see them with his eyes? Sweet is the sleep of a laborer, whether he eats little or much. But the full stomach of the rich will not let him sleep. He has made this point a couple other times back in chapter 1, that the eye is never full with seeing and the ear is never filled with hearing. In this case, he talks about it when it comes to the love of money. How much money is enough? Or he actually asked the question back in chapter 1, who can count what is lacking? How much money is going to make you satisfied? Can you count the quantity that is lacking in your bank account? If you love money, the answer is no. You can't count what's lacking for you to be content. And if you love wealth, you're not going to be satisfied with your income. Maybe you see that in your life, maybe you've seen it in other people's lives, where you think, oh, if only I could make this much more, if I got this raise, everything would be better in life, I'd be so much happier, bills would be easier. And then he gets into verse 11, whenever your income increases, what happens then?
There's more mouths to be feeding.
There are more cubby holes for the bills to come out of. It's amazing, whenever you get more money, all of a sudden you have more bills. It seems to never stop. And that's his point. And then let's... Sure. Yes.
I was going to say, we will get an increase in your salary, your insurance, and income tax and all of that increases too.
It does. It really does. I remember when Brittany and I were first married and we were poor enough that it was cheaper to be poor than it was to get a little bit more money and start having to pay for insurance and pay a lot more out of income tax. And whew, it was nice being poor. He then goes on to maybe even the next level. So as you increase your income and your bills and the amounts that eat it increase, he then asks, what if you even go above that? What if you have more than all of the bills and all the people who need it? What happens then? He asks the question, what advantage of it is it to the one who can only look at it with his eyes? If you become Scrooge McDuck and all you have is just an entire swimming pool of gold coins, what good is just money going to do if all you can do is just look at it? It doesn't really have an advantage at all. And so he'll talk about that a little bit later on, as you get into verse 13, of individuals who have wealth and then lose it through a variety of ways. But to contrast, the one who loves money and the one who loves wealth in verse 12 is the sleep of the laborer. Is that something that money can buy?
Well, that's
an awkward question. The answer is no. Weird side note, Michael Jackson, with all of his money, had a really hard time sleeping. Ended up being one of the reasons that he died when he died is because they put him into a medical induced coma every single night. Weird, weird stories. I don't understand why I even know this information. But that was, but metal, it's a side note because I looked up how comas work, how medically induced comas work, and they don't actually provide rest. Your body doesn't go through its natural recycle process, which kind of leads you further and further into insanity. So you keep yourself from sleeping naturally, you induce medical comas, and you actually drive yourself insane. Explains a lot. Solomon deals with this idea that sweet is the sleep of the laborer, but the full belly of the rich will not let him sleep. Here is something that money can't buy that I think almost all of us enjoy, probably a little bit too much sometimes. And he says that belongs not to the wealthy, but to the one who works hard. Now, you can work hard, you can be a laborer and become wealthy. But the work provides the sleep. What is it about the stomach of the rich that keeps him from sleep? It's becoming 30 and getting acid reflux, isn't it? That's just what it is. Indigestion. Or, you know, part of it is just that, you know, that uncomfortableness of someone who's gorged themselves before bed.
We got a lot of money, worry about robbers and different things. And you don't think about giving more to the church when they're supposed to.
Yeah, you have those who increase their money also increase their worries about it. And that is a huge part of it. So, we got 30 seconds. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Someone had pointed this out recently, made this point. I thought it was an excellent point, so I will share it with you and then claim it for my own. This is my own point, so no one else has led me down this path. 1 Timothy chapter 6, Paul deals with the idea in verse 6 that godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of this world. But if we have food and covering, or food and clothing, with these we shall be content. So there's the level of contentment that he is calling for us. If we have nothing but food and clothing, or food and covering, with that we should be content. And then, what happens if we don't? He says in verse 9, those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evils, and through its cravings some have wandered away from the faith and have pierced themselves through with many pangs. The level of worldly goods that he has placed for us is not the level where we place the bar. So we think, I don't have a love of money, and I don't pierce myself through with many pangs. But he says, if we are not able to be content with food and covering, any our desire or our demand for anything above that will pierce us through with many pangs and bring about many sorrows. It's a whole different level of contentment that we're really kind of comfortable with. And if you think back in the last year, 2 years, how much have we worried about things beyond food and clothing? How many worries has that occupied our minds? How many nights have we wrestled with sleeping because we didn't know exactly what was going to happen beyond food and clothing? Which is, it's a bit of an eye-opener. It puts a different level on the love of money than I have previously had read through 1 Timothy. So Solomon deals with this, that the sleep of the laborer is sweet, but the full stomach of the rich will not let him sleep. And while sometimes it is a literal full stomach, sometimes it's actual indigestion, but sometimes it is the worry and the consumption of our minds with all the worldly things that goes along with that. So we'll pick up there next week in verse 13. We'll have a few verses through chapter 5, and if you guys will, go ahead and read through chapter 6. Chapter 6 is not the happiest of chapters. It's another one of those chapters that begins with under the sun, and it is rife with vanity. So, not the happiest of chapters, but definitely ones worthwhile wrestling through. So we'll try to finish up chapter 5 next week, and then get into chapter 6. Thank you, guys.